On Story is brought to you in part by the Alice Clayburgh Reynolds Foundation, a Texas family providing innovative funding since 1979. Story, presented by Austin Film Festival, a look inside the creative process from today's leading writers and directors. On this week's On Story, Mystic River and LA Confidential screenwriter Brian Helgeland, along with Iron Man 3 and Kiss Kiss Bang Bang writer-director Shane Black.
There's an honesty, ultimately, I think, to noir, which says, you know what, to hell with the romanticized version. Let's rip it open and see the raw kind of real story. And then the trick is, you say, now, you see how depressing and raw and real this is? It's actually romantic. And that's the trick of noir to me.
In this episode, Shane Black and Brian Helgeland discuss the styles, impulses, themes, and tones that embrace modern-day neo-noir films.
We both have a love of kind of old-school novels and screenplays that are sort of steeped in that flavor, which has been oft sort of, I don't know, cannibalized to the form of pastiche, where there's not a lot of passion in noir. There's just a lot of replication of the sort of elements that people associate with a detective story. And I think that the lighting, the presence of cigarettes, and the interjection of like tough talk has been too often mistaken for the genuine soul of what an old school detective story actually has the opportunity to be.
To me, I love those movies because they're small. The stakes are there's no stakes except for one guy, his life or everything about him might be at stake. But as far as the world goes, if he dies in the first 5 minutes, or if he dies at the end of the movie, it's not going to change a single thing. And that's what I associate with noir in a general sort of way.
And I think when you say the stakes are small, you mean that in terms of the universe being affected by an individual's actions, it's not like he's changing the world, but to him, the stakes are incredibly high. It's this do or die thing that may ultimately be a fool's errand or sort of a tilting at a windmill. Chinatown, I think, is a perfect example. Yeah. Of a guy at the end, this thing which to him had become this quixotic quest ends in the worst possible way.
Turn them loose, turn them all loose.
The fact that he cared amounts to something, and it means something. And I think so often that's what's important, is that the fact that the main character cared is what makes a difference, not the fact that he wins.
You want to do your partner a big favor? Take him home. Take him home! Just get him the hell out of here! Go home, Jake. I'm doing you a favor. Come on, Jake.
Forget it, Jake. It's Chinatown.
There's an element of the caper that I always loved, of a guy who is engaged to do something, usually small, usually against his better judgment, that escalates. And I think that was the model I first heed to, was this sort of, you want to start your private eye story or your noir story with absolute grounding in a realistic day in the life. Because detectives don't go out and get shot at. They don't pull guns and chase people down the street. But you can have that. You start with a detective who finds something minimal that everyone else dismisses, the dead girl who overdosed, but he thinks, wait, something's not right. That doesn't feel like an overdose to me. And by the end of the story, it's escalated to, you know, the highest political office in the city or something. It's that kind of feeling. I mean, you saw it brilliantly in L.A. Confidential with these guys whose everyday lives were as relatable and as absolutely etched and well drawn as anything regarding the mystery. It's also about broken people and people who in real life are desperate and living lives of quiet desperation, who normally wouldn't take the next step, which is put someone in a trunk, or, you know, no matter how much your husband natters at you, the wife wouldn't pull a knife and stab him in real life. But in these books and these stories, that quiet desperation verges into something else that allows for the intensity level.
I just wanted to lose my cherry. She don't die, so I don't die. She don't die, so I don't die.
Lewis, who's the girl? What's her name?
Who are you talking about? Was she at the night out? Lewis, listen to me. Was she at the night out?
She don't die, so I don't die.
This newspaper shit ain't shit. Where's the girl Fontaine's talking about?
Did you kill her? You wanted Lewis to lose his cherry, but that wasn't enough. So things got out of hand, and you made her bleed. She bled on your clothes, so you burned the clothes.
I told you that!
Now listen to me. If that girl is still alive, she's the only chance you've got.
I think she's alive!
You think?
Then where is she now?
Did you leave her someplace? Did you sell her out?
Tell me where she is!
Move!
I got asked this question a long time ago about what noir is, and or I'll leave the Neo out of it for now, and there's a funny example. I don't have this just off the top of my head, so I copped to having looked it up before a couple of years ago, but there's the Maltese Falcon and Casablanca were made about 9 months apart, and they have the same, they both have, Hal Wallace produced both of them. The crew is identical. They have the same DP, the same costume designer, same hair and makeup department. They both have Humphrey Bogart. They both have Sidney Greenstreet. They both have Pierre Lorre. I think one's 41 and one's 42 or something like that. And you would never in a million years say Casablanca is film noir, but obviously the Maltese Falcon is. And I think weirdly it's because Humphrey Bogart is having an actual effect on World War II in one movie, and in the other movie, it's meaningless what he's doing. Except to him, to bring that kind of back again.
There is an element to the true noir film of the existential. It's the sort of wanderer who meets out his own particular brand of justice, which doesn't have to do with the police. It has to do with a conviction on the part of the main character that they have figured out that someone deserves to be punished and someone doesn't. And by the end, there's a conflagration of a personal nature where in Chinatown, or it's this horribly deformed sort of family involving an incestuous father that collapses on itself and implodes.
And don't give me that crap about your sister, because you don't have a sister.
I'll tell you the truth.
Good. What's her name?
Catherine.
Catherine who?
She's my daughter.
I said I want the truth.
She's my sister. She's my daughter. My sister, my daughter.
I said I want the truth! No!
In the good stories, to me, there's a little bit of a redemption where the detective, by the end, decides that this character needs to walk because they can skate on this. They did something bad, but they, you know, this character, on the other hand, to escape punishment, and seems like, well, really, I've unearthed your secret, buddy, and you deserve to pay. And everything is arranged so that the detective walks away with the you know, metaphorically burning house behind them. The family secrets have emerged. The skeletons have lapsed from their closets, and everything is laying bare and exposed to the world. And he just walks away counting his change, having sort of meted out that personal reckoning of, and leaving in his wake this sort of catastrophic trail of crying people. And that, to me, is a satisfying noir, where you've satisfyingly brought to light all those, you know, unexposed secrets. Chinatown is a perfect example of a guy who is flawed and drinks and is licentious and lecherous and obviously just about money and getting clients. And he has a very, very broken moral compass. He's the one thing that characterizes him that makes us like the guy in Chinatown is he happens to be really good at what he does, even despite himself, even in a dissipated state, having come to a very low point in his career where he doesn't really believe in much and he's taking photographs of people's wives getting shtupped in a field. He still has this potential within him to be something more that he's buried and sort of drowned over the years, but that's becomes ignited. It's about the thing in you that becomes ignited and wants to pursue a slightly more rarefied version of justice, a calling that, that whispers to you that you're something more and you have to wake up and pursue that.
May I speak frankly, Mrs. Mulray?
Oh, yeah, you can, Mr. Gittes.
Well, that little girlfriend, she was pretty in a cheap sort of a way, of course. She's disappeared. Maybe they disappeared together.
Suppose they did. How does that affect you?
It's nothing personal, Mrs. Mulray.
It's very personal. It couldn't be more personal. Is it a business or an obsession with you?
Let's look at it this way. Now, this phony broad, excuse the language, she tells me she's you, she hires me. Now, whoever put her up to it doesn't have anything against me. They're out to get your husband. If I can see him, I can help him.
He comes to care deeply about something to the point where he becomes a knight, in a sense. And that's what ultimately these stories, like whether it's Travis McGee or Jack Reacher, they're modern day knights, but their armor is a little bit rusty and tarnished, you know, and they're not as good as they used to be quite often. Noir stories are often reflective of the gunslinger whose day is past, but who has to summon up once again that sense of what he once was or can be again. Unforgiven is a film noir, possibly the best one in recent years. As we talk about all these very dramatic, sort of melodramatic concepts, you start to get a picture, I think, of just this dark moral struggle tempered with a landscape of sadness and mundanity that by the end has been twisted into a construct which is somehow dramatic and operatic. You could go, I think operas are film noir, you know.
I think the sort of underlying what Shane said is also that in the, as far as nights and all that goes is the pursuit of the truth and that kind of relentless pursuit of the truth in the face of people pointing guns in your face and saying to go away is a redemptive thing for the character. So he needs to, if he's going to get redemption for himself, he needs to follow this through to the bitter end, no matter what the cost is. And just since we had a little list going, I think The Limey actually is a really great recent noir where he comes to town. It's very simple. He comes to town to find out. He doesn't believe his daughter died in a car accident, and he comes to town to figure it out.
There was an investigation, okay? The car was total. Jenny was, her neck was broken, they said, an impact. So she wouldn't have felt the effects of the fire.
Those streets up them hills, man, you gotta be careful, you know, you gotta keep your eyes on the ball. 2 o'clock in the morning, it's dark, your mind's a little agitated, you're driving a little too fast. Those curves don't kid around.
Could have happened to anybody. I mean, I didn't know Jenny to be reckless, but you know, she'd have a drink here and smoke a little pot, and that was it, nothing more than that.
No, not my girl. Self-control she had.
An often repeated theme is that the crimes happened years ago and had been covered up, and everyone who's involved in the crime has moved on, and one person comes in and starts to unravel it, and that's kind of a classic structure for it also.
the notion in movies that we can explore the walk on the dark side and tread there and then take a step back before we, you know, step over and they're lost forever. I think that's one of the joys and one of the true gifts movies give us, and this ability to take a walk on this dark side. One of my favorite film noirs, which is very flawed, is this thing with George C. Scott called Hardcore from the 70s, about a father who goes to LA to find his daughter, who he discovers is basically run away from her small Christian community and is doing porn films on the West Coast. And he's an evangelical who, and there's one scene where this prostitute and he are sharing a hotel room, and he obviously just has no respect for this woman. He feels that she's in violation of everything he's been brought up to believe. And she tells him her life, and he goes, that's ridiculous what you're telling me. I've never heard anything so ridiculous. This is crazy, what you live and how you live. And then she asks him some questions, and he starts describing his evangelical background. You realize he's just as nuts.
I mean, if God is omniscient, if he knows everything, and he wouldn't be God if he didn't, then he must have known, even before the creation of the world, the names of those who would be saved.
Well, then it's all worked out. It's fixed.
More or less.
I thought I was f***ed up.
And it's those little moments along the journey of these two bizarrely fractured characters, you know, sharing their fractures that, to me, almost brings tears to my eyes to see. It's that kind of vulnerable humanity, that brokenness that emerges, that is particularly suited to a film about a guy who's questing to find his daughter in the world of pornography in L.A. Romantic, quixotic, lonely, very important. Lonely characters, and something Goldman says, which we shouldn't give short shrift to, characters who, despite their loneliness, their misanthropy, their absolute inability to fit in a world that's just not available to them, that most people just sort of take for granted, but they're great at something. They're really good at doing something that other people can't do. For whatever reason, as alienated as they are, there's some one thing which, when they turn it on, man, that's better than you. And it's better than me, it's better than anybody. It seems to me that the best noir stories to me are about a moral compass and a sense of lapsed conviction or something that someone's trying to uphold and others have forgotten. If there's a bad movie, but it's got a great idea behind it called The Big Fix, which is about all the weathermen underground in the 1960s, these people who fought, you know, against Vietnam and put, you know, stickers on police cars and blew things up with pipe bombs. And now they're just barbecue dads. And there's something wonderfully noirish about that. And it's even reflected in reality by the soccer mom that was arrested. You know, 30 years on, she's got this great family, she's the head of the community, but she blew up a police car in 1968. So they hauled her in when she's 45 years old and said, sorry, but you gotta pay. You know, we know you're a pillar of the community and you have three kids and they play soccer, but you have to pay for what you did. Because your conviction has lapsed, but your legacy, you know, precedes you. And that to me is an essential part of this type of writing, of whether it's a detective story or just a noir per se, is that there is someone in the midst of all this nonsense who has a conviction that is desperately trying to uphold or justify something. That's why alcoholism plays such a firm part, I believe, in these sorts of stories, is because alcoholism is about that flirting with the edge where you want to have a conviction, but you're always on the edge of lapsing into just abandoning everything you believe and holding on to everything you believe at the edge of that precipice where it's so tempting and so easy to spill over into disbelief and just disillusion. I mean, these are kind of very dark and very sort of somber concepts, but they figure prominently to me in this. Even Mad Men. I mean, the lives of quiet desperation, the moral compass gone astray, the guy who's, you see do bad things, but then something pulls, just when you're about to lose faith in him, there's an element that seems somehow knight-like and redemptive in him. I mean, that's what it's about. It's not about the lighting. It's about the knight's quest gone astray. It's a, you know, And usually it involves a landscape like the ad agency in the 1960s, which is completely morally without a compass. There is nothing there to determine the extent of right and wrong except your own individual tenacity to hang on to something in the midst of all those temptations. So much of noir to me is about the presence of temptation, the devil on your shoulder, and will you succumb to it or not?
No, it's because I always, the way I define it is someone with a code, and they're, and they've created a difficult code for themselves, which has made them lonely and drunk sometime, and all those kind of things, and someone comes in sometimes that the whole point is that it tests that code that person lives by, and if they walk that line, it doesn't mean things are going to turn out well, but they can kind of look themselves in the mirror at the end.
If we establish noir as a blanket term, which means a story about an existential struggle within an individual whose moral compass is struggling to say, to point towards true north while, you know, he's in an imperfect world walking these sorts of mean streets, as Chandler put it, if it has to do with sort of dissipated people or sun-blinded streets, you know, in Los Angeles, sort of baking under this endless sun with no seasons, and just that in each of these sort of little hovels in the valley exists the potential for salvation and damnation. I mean, this is all very hyperbolic, as I'm saying, but if you look at it in terms of quiet, you know, everyday mundane settings having the potential to contain great, almost operatic drama, then I think we're in the land of noir. It exists across generations. There's a certain madness, I think, and a certain bizarre quality of violence in noir films where it's devastating. It's not just ongoing. It's not just clever. It's devastating and often sort of, you know, the sort of violence where you walk away scratching your head and you see there's blood on your hand because you got speckled with it and you didn't realize it. It's that kind of offbeat violence that I find so appealing. Oh, the Double Indemnity, the bullet at the end of Double Indemnity. One gunshot from Fred McMurray and Barbara Stanwyck, the look on her face, that to me is what sums it up, is the ability to devastate and you know, just take apart a moment in time and really examine what violence is, what it feels like, what it means, and what it registers as in the mind of the character.
Until a minute ago, when I couldn't fire that second shot, I never thought that could happen to me.
Sorry, baby, I'm not buying.
I'm not asking you to buy, just hold me close.
Goodbye, baby.
A great noir character is kind of the same guy going out as he is coming in. There's always that. People talk about a character has to change in a movie, which I don't buy into. And Buddy Beatty does have to realize something, maybe, or figure something out.
I think it's about pretty much the struggle within an individual in a dark landscape, which represents or reflects his own mind. There's an element of German expressionism in noir, where the outside and the sort of the streets you're walking are a reflection of your own inner path. And there's a darkness in the lighting and a sort of harshness in the shadows and an uplighting or a downlighting that reflects an angularity, all these things. But boy, it's hard to just define what I like about the term noir. I think a lot of it has to do with sex. I think noir is about sexual paranoia in men, the fact that women are gonna eat you like a praying mantis. It's about desperation and being ruled by base desires versus the impulse to somehow sustain and resist and do something stronger and more illustrious by the end of your life. And also, there's a strong element of sadness. So to me, noir stories are not, they're adventure stories tinged with desperation, potential for futility and just ultimate sadness, wrenching revelations, which seem in retrospect so ultimately sad when they come out, they almost wish no one had revealed the truth because it's so, you know, the question a lot of good noir asks for me is, should you really have pulled that up out of the lake? Or should it have best been left at the bottom of the water?
You've been watching Shane Black and Brian Helgeland on Story. For more On Story, check out our free podcast at onstory.tv or search the iTunes store and get the book today, On Story, Screenwriters and Their Craft, on Amazon.